Hello everyone, this is Romy, your friend, your mentor, your guide, your host and your teacher. So today, as promised, I am here with a lecture, an introduction to Indian English literature. So before we start, let me tell you to do like this video, comment in the comment box and also subscribe to my channel and share this video. Our literary classics Lakshya UGC NET 2020 has been started, so admissions are open. Do not waste your time, join us fast because we have Lakshya NET 2020 of June exam and Lakshya UGC NET JRF 2020 for December exam. Students have joined us already, so do not waste your time. Call us fast and the link of the admission has been given in the description box. So don't waste your time and join us. So let us move to the lecture. That is the beginning of British Raj in India. Why I use the term Raj? Because Raj shows the exact flavor of British rule as compared to imperialism or rule. So firstly, let us jump to historical significances. In 1800, the British domination started over India, and it was not only from British but from other European powers such as Dutch, French, Portuguese and other people. And dominion was not only social, cultural, political, but it was economical as well. So what do I mean here? The term, see, 1800 does not have any literary significance, but it is important to know where and when it actually started. So by 1800, the Battle of Plassey and Boxar were fought and were lost by the Nawabs, the Mughals. So the loss was less at the hands of Colonel Robert Clive, but more at the hands of Hindu Jagat Seth. So that means Hindu people were somewhat entangled with the British to throw over the rule of Mughals. So this provided a way to British to enter India as they win the side of public. So the Hindus and Jain merchants and East India Company plotted to overthrow Nawab. Here we are talking about Nawab Sirajuddaula. So there were only 72 dead on both sides. So can you imagine that only 72 people died and the king was killed? So that means it is all about the plot. So the Orientalist Joshua Marshman wrote in his influential book Bharat Vashtithas, where he said that the war changed the fate of over 60 million people in the Vast Kingdom. So battle was fought, and this battle brought Bengal under the rule of East India Company, and Battle of Boxer brought Awadh under the same. So that means the East India Company by now had, you know, overpowered the gigantic plains, Bihar, Odisha, Bengal, and they started collecting revenue by their own. If you have read history, naturally, you have read in your junior classes till matriculation. So, if you have any link with the history, you might track it how it was all happening. Now, Benjamin West painting. Robert Clive, when was offered a grant by Mughal emperor. Now, this painting, I will show you how it is prepared. See, this is the painting. Here we have Robert Clive and with him we have six Englishmen, Nawab in his imperial setting, offering a rolled paper to Clive, and the Englishmen, they are talking with each other. So this is the setting of Benjamin West painting. But this was not actual. The actual painting is something else. So actual painting is what? Actual painting is Robert Clive got this paper in his tent. that means how literature and painting and art is overpowering the exact situation. That means here we start talking about literature and art when there are discrepancies between what actually happened and what it is shown. So let us talk about literary significances. Dean Muhammad wrote The Travels of Dean Muhammad. Now see the spellings of Muhammad and Muhammad. So that means Indian version and English version has changed the spellings also. So this book is the first book ever written and published by an Indian in English. So this is an important fact, literary fact, that may help you in cracking your UGC NET also. This is the first book of diaspora literature, as Muhammad went to Europe as he was a part of Bengal army. So that means this is the first diaspora book also, number one. And number two, it is the first book ever written by an Indian. So this book is a form of letters to his fictive friend. Now, British and Indian languages. Now, when something acquires someone, when any rule started in a country, the first major thing is ruling over the language or learning language. Earlier, when Britishers came, these Britishers are known as Orientalists. When the Orientalists came, their first agenda was to acquire Indian languages. Why? To talk to the public, to complete the needs and necessities of government. So they furnished themselves with Persian and Sanskrit. Nathaniel Bressy Hallett, the first Englishman to be inspired by Orient mysticism. Now I have written the word mysticism. That means the flavor of Indianhood. It was considered that Indians are somewhat that they are climbing the horses always. They are riding the elephants always. So this was a look, the typical look that has been maintained by the Indians and the Britishers. Another one is Sir William Jones, Calcutta Supreme Judge and the founder of Asiatic Society, Bengal. In the third anniversary of discourse, he made an assertion that Sanskrit and Greek and Latin have sprung up from a common source. So this person was not only talking about the language acquisition, but the language formation also. Now, Hindu College. The founding of imparting colonial education. Hindu College was built in 1817 and it was built for the sons of Hindu Rajas. The formation of Hindu College was debated everywhere. Everywhere means in London and Calcutta. Why? Because Britishers think that if they impart Indians with the knowledge of English, so this is the same mistake they are repeating as they did with America. You know, America was also dominated by the Europeans and America got its independence in 1776. And they thought that they did the mistake by letting the people of America know English. And same mistake is being repeated in India. The issue was taken up by Committee of Protestant Society. Now, Raja Ram Mohan Roy. You might be aware with Raja Ram Mohan Roy. A very historical figure and also involved in literature. So he said that Sanskrit system of education would be best calculated to keep the country in darkness. Now, if I talk about darkness, he felt that though everything is in English, English has become a global language. Now, and he was assuming the future. He was thinking that the thing will happen when we cannot live without English. And it is stupidity to convert everything in Sanskrit. So he was in favor of establishing a Hindu college. In 1835, Minute on Education by T.B. Macaulay. You might have heard this. T.B. Macaulay compared the system of literature of India without reading to English literature, and he says that the whole Indian literature is not even equal to one slab of English literature. One slab of books filled with English literature is much more than the whole Indian literature. So this question also came in net. Salman Rushdie, the last Mursae, has talked about this minute on education by Macaulay in his work. So Hindu college, as I have already said, established for the sons of Hindu people, Hindu rajas. Now English learning. How the English, when it was established and the people of India started learning English. In the villages of Bengal, Lal Bihari Day, in his recollection of my school days, he said, English was learnt in such a manner. God, Ishwara, Lord, Ishwara, Bale, Jameel. So this is the terminology. This is the thing that was taught to the villagers of Bengal when it started with learning of English. Other books famous were Spelling Book, Schoolmaster, Arabian Nights Entertainment. And Arabian Nights Entertainment, you might be knowing about this book. There was some other that were considered at that time to be taught in the senior classes. And those who were able to read and comprehend Arabian Nights were considered as the full learners of English. So you can see how environment was there about English learning. Firstly, this English was learned by the Britishers, and not sorry, the firstly the language of Indians was learned by the Britishers, and now English is taught in Indian schools and colleges. So we have something more for you. Are you enjoying the lecture? Same lecture, if you have any demand, we are providing you the lecture in just rupees 150. Any topic you have, you can select, or you have any problem in any theory, you can select, or sometimes it's an age that you are facing problem with, or any two authors. So we will provide you notes, MCQs, and books. So if you do not want to join coaching as such, but you have problems in multiple things, or two or three things, so do not waste your time. Call us fast, and the link to this lecture on demand has been given in description box. So now come to adopting of English. Indian mastered colonial language not only as a language of learning, but as a medium of expression also. So the letters, dramas, poetry, fiction were written that are little read today, but at that time it was having a large, long impact. Famous literature in English. Krishan Mohan Banerjee's The Persecuted. Kailash Chandra Dutt's Journey of 48 Hours of the Year 1945. It is an imaginary uprising against the British rule. Now see, if you put focus on Kailash Chandra Dutt's journal, or what we can say, an essay, a writing piece, how he has talked about 1945, and we got independence in 1947. So things are related. That means he had a vision that something will happen that way. But this book doesn't become, this essay doesn't become very famous because people thought, or we can say people were not aware of it. They were not thinking about the overthrow of English. Likewise, they did with the Mughals. Then, translation. Now, people started translating the works of English into Indian languages. By this translation, now, They were coping up with the literature of Europeans and translating it to Indian languages. That means they want Indians should read the literature. Though all the Indians were not able enough to read the literature properly, so they were translating, such as Rangalal Banerjee's Padmini Ukhayan, which is a translation of James Todd's Annals and Antiquities of Rajasthan. So this book is about Hindu valor and heroism in medieval times during the reign of Alauddin Khilji. See, now we can well imagine that how Indians and English are writing about India. But the attitude of English is for Indians is of Orientalists. And Indians at that time didn't realize that. They were continuously translating the work. So we can say that the awakening is nil here. And Chandu Menon's Indu Lekha. It's a translation, attempted translation of Benjamin Disraeli's Henrietta Temple, but he later abandoned the idea and started writing his own novel. That is why Chandu Menon's Indu Lekha is still read today, because there is something new. Then, borrowing and reception of literary style. Prose, realist novels, blank verse, sonnets, this is all copied, or we can say borrowed and recepted from Britishers and English language. And this is visible in Indian literatures now. Rabindranath Tagore, and Nobel Prize. So Tagore wrote Gitanjali and got Nobel for this. But can you imagine that the Nobel we got in 1913, and right now we do not have a person with Indian citizenship having Nobel? Why? Apart from some writers such as, we can say, V.S. Naipaul, he was living in Trinidad and Tobago, but his nationhood or nationhood is not fully Indian. So we have not got Nobel until now. Why? So there was a lot of hand, what we can say, impression of W.B. Yeats, impact of W.B. Yeats on the idea of giving Nobel to Rabindranath Tagore. So this was a question asked in NET also. When I qualified NET, this was a question asked. So you have to read the literatures comparatively, that how Indian literature is affected by the Britishers. Now, nationalist period, there was call to nationalhood now. People started realizing with the literatures of Mahatma Gandhi that nationhood is important. So, awakening started here. There is a call to Indian literatures for permanence. Bengali Renaissance, these are the writers of Bengali Renaissance. These writers not only have written in Bengali, but also in English. So these writers are important from English, Indian English literature from UGC NET perspective. Now, writers in English in nationalism, nationalistic mode. So these are the works, Venkat Ramani's, Muruganda Tillar, Babani Bhattacharya, So Many Hunger, a very canonical work, Mulk Raj Untouchable, Gandhi's Young India, followed by different writers. Now, if you read these novels are about casteism, number one, the Indian society and the condition of peasantry, number two, and number three, the untouchability also. So, Indian people started writing in this manner. Then comes to status of English after independence. After this time period, we have got independence. And after Gandhi's, Nehru's contribution, you all know, we are not talking about history now. We are talking about history of literature. So we are omitting these movements. We are only focusing on language and literature. So in the Constitution of India in 1950, Hindi was given the status of official language. But Until 15 years, that is 1955, English will continue to be used, and then it was eliminated. Gandhi's vision of language is Hindustani, a mixture of Hindi and Urdu. But there was a clash between North and South Indian people on the matters of language. Official Language Bill 1963. Now, it was considered that up to 1965, English will be used. The clock was ticking. And Nehru stopped his clock in 1963 by saying that English will be continued to use as official language. Now, we got independence and the time is of 1963-65 and up to 80. So, Indian started being recognized, Indian English being recognized in the world. For example, Budeva Bose's entry into Concise Encyclopedia of English and American Poets. The terminology Indo-Anglican was formed. The people from different social groups of India, they were talking about the pros and cons of English literature in India. Some were saying that it is better to use Indian languages to be acclaimed properly. But others were saying that we should not lose our identity and we should speak English and write English in English tone but Indian flavor. So that means they were forming Indo-Anglican literature. So for its con, Shyamalal's famous comment, that is Matthew Arnold in sari or Shakuntala in skirts. So it is the touch, he said, we are giving to language. Now, by this time, we are in 21st century and post-colonialism emerged. We have third world literature. Writers such as Pibak talking about third world feminism, diasporic literature, for example, Homi Bhabha. Homi Bhabha is Indian but living in USA and he talks about hybridity, a post-colonial impact. That we are neither properly Indians, the diasporics are neither properly Indians nor properly Westerners. They are something lying in between. So, other writers such as Jhumpa Lahiri, Indra Sinha, these are the writers that are talking about post-coloniality. Also, Edward Said's writing of Orientalism, Homi Bhabha's cultural hybridity, Boomer's writings about post-colonial history are there that are talking about not only Indian but other colonized countries and their literature in English. So I hope you have got the point that how we started from 1800 and today now, how English as a language, as a literature traveled in India. So do not forget to like, share, comment and subscribe to my channel. Share this video with your friends. Let them be entitled, enlightened. And if you have any queries, do comment here in the comment section. You can call us also, ping us also on WhatsApp. We are available. We have given our number. For notes, see description box. There is a link. There is a form you have to fill. And then you will get the form in your mail ID. So thank you. Keep watching. Stay tuned with me. Bye-bye.